I am on a quest. I want to find out how to make software and hardware perform at their peak. I want to know how to make applications faster and more efficient. And while I'm at it, I want to have a little fun. Don't think I can do it? Just watch me. I'm Scott Moore, and this is The Performance Tour.
Hey everybody, Scott Moore for The Performance Tour, suffering here in a tropical climate during winter, but somebody's got to do it. Hey, I want to give a big shout out to everybody who attended our Nashville meetup back in October, and especially Vaco in Nashville for hosting that. Man, we had a great time, we had some great barbecue, and we even had a bluegrass band. Check it out. So let's get to today's show. I want to introduce you to somebody that I've known for quite some time. And it's one of these situations where you just want to have a conversation with a performance engineer who has a lot of experience and a passion for what they do. I mean, if you had the chance and an opportunity to talk to somebody who had this much experience in a field and you want to know, you know, what makes you tick? What are the things that you think are important? What would you talk about? That's what I wanted to do, and that's what we will do on today's episode. Okay, so today we are here with Mike Hawkins of Tricentis. Thanks for being on the Performance Tour with me today, buddy.
Glad to be here.
We've known each other for quite some time, and that's a whole different story and a whole different interview for later. But Mike has such an extensive experience with performance engineering throughout the years, and I wanted to get him aside and kind of talk about some of the things that you're passionate about, because you've done a lot. Right? You've seen what goes wrong at companies at a really big level, and you've had to do assessments on these companies.
Yeah, that's right.
So first of all, tell me about you and how you got to where you're at today. Like, how did you get all this knowledge and introduce yourself to our audience? And then we'll kind of go from there as to what you're seeing out there.
My name is Mike Hawkins, and I've been doing performance engineering over 20 years. And, you know, it started out load testing. And then as the years have progressed, and as performance engineering has progressed, and the industry as a whole has progressed, it's moved beyond, of course, just performance testing or load testing into all areas within IT. So I've just been able to ensure that I've kept up with that and tried to be a leader in that area.
Things have changed over the last 20 years.
Yes.
And I've seen that, you've seen that. Tell me about your experience going into large companies. And what I want to find out is, what are they getting wrong? What's the common thing that you see that ends up falling through the cracks regarding performance? What ends up biting them in the end?
Performance engineering touches so many areas, as you're aware of. We talked about load testing quite a bit, and that seems to be where everybody likes to start or focus. But also, even up to the business level, until you have proper targets, until you have a way to be able to measure properly what your performance is for your application as a whole and then individual components, until you have those targets and are monitoring against those, I would say that's an Achilles heel where it all starts. The assessments that I found, very, very few organizations have SLAs. You know, these organizations, they've got business critical applications that are just absolutely dependent on like a third-party API calls for data from those third-party calls. And yet they don't even have a signed agreement on what that performance of that particular API needs to be.
So is shift left figuring out the problem? Is it just letting the developers run a
a load test earlier for smaller amounts of people. Is that solving the problem, or is there something else that, because I don't think that's solving the problem.
That is not solving the problem. Now, I will say that is part of the solution, part of it, right? But until you have, from an executive perspective, right? And then you have, I always, you call it a performance czar, you call it whatever you want to call it, performance architect, but have one person who is responsible for the performance across the board for your organization is really the way to go. Because what I've seen in these organizations, and we're talking very large, telecommunications industry, medical industry, all these different industries, is that the performance engineering or performance testing tends to be ad hoc most of the time. It's within these silos. And what ends up happening is you've got these large companies that are literally piling up cash and burning it and don't even know because they're not centralizing this to and then have an executive buy-in.
But do you think that the reason why it hasn't really been solved is because there's no one who gets the stuff that's in the weeds that makes good performance engineering possible and somebody who gets business context? You got people who understand the business and the executive level making the decisions about that, how they run their business, but they don't necessarily get this. And then these folks who are doing it don't necessarily understand the impact that they're making. You think that's the big disconnect and you need somebody who can bridge the gap? Or is it just we have done a poor job of educating the executive level, saying, hey, let me tell you why this is so valuable, why you should pay attention to it more? Is it our fault?
Well, I would say partially.
I would say
that's not a either or question, because really both of those are there's truth in both of them, right? We haven't done a good enough job. Now, granted, it's difficult when you're in the weeds, you're doing these assessments, you're only getting buy-in, it's usually one executive, and so sometimes it's an uphill battle, right? We know that. But the it's education is the key. Educating from our perspective and finding those unicorns is what we're talking about here. And that's people who can actually bridge that gap between the performance and how it affects the business. And specifically, let's get down to it, profit.
And the other side of it is that education of, you can't go to school and learn this. And most of the time you're saying it's all ad hoc, and that's just because that's the way it's had to be up to now. And you're usually responding to a problem is when you learn about this. And then you think, well, we should be doing this more so we don't ever have this happen again. And that's how the learning begins. But then it's usually only a small handful of people that do that and get involved. Eventually they move on to other companies or they move on to other positions, and somehow that knowledge gets lost, But don't you think that it's something where we need almost like a formal education for these folks?
Oh, man, that actually makes a lot of sense. Including certifications that go along with that. The reality is if you're doing performance engineering correctly within your organization, you have a competitive advantage.
Right.
Period.
Yeah.
And that's the first step that has to be made. You have to help them to understand that.
All right. Yeah. And it's not something you can just hand off to this developer over here. You're just over performance. It's a niche. It's a niche skill set.
It's a niche skill set.
And you have somebody that focuses on it.
That's right.
So, Mike, I know that one other thing that you've had a lot of experience in, especially in these larger companies, is they've got these big, massive, complex applications, lots of moving parts. You've got to performance test this, and you've got to get as much coverage as you can, and you end up with 4,000 little scripts that automate through the application, and that is not very maintainable. So I know you've got experience saying, why don't we figure out a way to consolidate this, modularize things where you've got fewer overall automation processes, but they're easier to maintain. Can you talk about what your approach is to that, how you do that?
It gets to be a real pain when you're trying to handle hundreds or thousands of scripts, and you've got different modules within an application suite. And so what I've done is over the years, I've figured out, first of all, if you've got a specific module within an application that is hit often, even with as many different use cases, there's no reason why you can't have a specific piece of script, code, or whatever tool you're using to be able to handle that specific task within within your scripting framework, right? So why not have one module that'll take you to that point, and then one individual one for each of those permutations? That's the idea. And you can't be fearful of it. A lot of times engineers won't do that because they're scared. They're fearful. Oh my gosh, now once I start doing this, I may never get this script to work again. Trust your instincts. It can be done. You just work through each of the permutations and determine and ensure that whatever data in you've got, you can handle it on the other side. Put in proper logic. I mean, I could go on about this.
You know. But you're really talking about a Lego approach, right?
You're
breaking down the application to its smallest components that you can.
Yeah.
You start building it with Legos, and then you make sure that the code within each can continue the state so that it maintains the state.
Maintains the state.
And that you're making sure you're verifying that if you get something back you shouldn't be getting, you know how to deal with that logically.
That's right.
And that you're able to feed it different data and...
It works. And it works.
Yeah.
That's right.
So once you've built this, like I know that one example you were talking about, like you had this many scripts and it went from this to this. And how did that help the flow of how fast you could deliver tests
per
build, per release?
Yeah. This particular client, it was 97 scripts. And we went down, I got it down to 3 master scripts.
So the 3 master scripts were pretty much the driver of all the Lego blocks.
Underneath.
Yeah.
And they were really struggling there. They had 10% error rates. And frankly, most of that was data and state issues and blah, 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 blah. We've all been there. But we got that error rate down below 0.5%. We were able to go through, I would say, an order of magnitude, 10 times the data permutations, which is critical, as you know, because
much more coverage,
so that you're not, you know, a lot of times they were not even exercising the database because they were caching so much of their information at the service layer.
I see.
Right. So, and then it was averaging about a 2-week process for them, which they thought was pretty good to turn these scripts around. We got it to less than 2 days.
Which is awesome. And so more tests and more coverage means less risk and more money back in your pocket, basically, because
Absolutely. You're
able to get more done. And you don't have to worry about when you roll it out to production. You know what's going to happen And so were you able to get some of the edge cases as well, or did you just focus on the core there and just expand from there?
Well, we of course get the core. We got the core done, and then you know that's what you always want to do. But eventually, you get to all of these edge cases.
So, being that we are what will probably be called old timers now in the industry, we've seen everything that's come up here. We've got some of that context, but people who are coming up now don't necessarily have the context that we had of client server, web, you know, HTTP 1.0 and now 2 and now 3 and now we're talking here about web version 3, you know, web 3. Mm-hmm. Then we've got this new Kubernetes that is becoming the operating system of the cloud. We have microservices. We have all these new things. But when it comes to performance engineering, how would you like advise somebody just like newly coming up, like where to even begin? Because it sounds like if I was just coming into it, I would be sort of overwhelmed with all this stuff. How do you approach testing performance engineering something and you just never even heard of it before, like something new when you come across it? How do you deal with that?
The reality is that no matter what, it's still ones and zeros. Mm-hmm. It's still CPU, it's still memory, it is still networking. It's just it's developing another layer of abstraction or whatever you want to call it on top of what's already there. So the foundational computing, the laws of physics don't change, right? Queuing theory does not change. You know, being an old timer, you know, I always liken almost like to Star Trek technology or so it seems, you know,
it is.
You know, it's divert the power to this or to that, you know, to the shields or to this. And it's kind of the same concept, right? But underneath, architecturally speaking, it's still a CPU somewhere that is executing commands, putting those on a bus, memory still being used to hold that information to be able to used when used by the application when necessary, and then long-term storage, I/O, and of course network to talk to other machines. Mm-hmm. So all of that's the same. So my advice would be, don't get overwhelmed. Go back to the basics. Understand the fundamentals of computing. You know, memory, disk, I/O, networking. That's where you start. Then you can work your way to, once you understand that and how to optimize that, then you can look at how to scale. So, you know, we've done horizontal scalability testing for 20 years, mm-hmm. let's face it. But the idea was you had bare metal, you knew the characteristics very well, you went through the scientific method, and it took, you know, you had time to determine what your bottlenecks were, and then be able to add a machine at the application layer, for instance, to scale it horizontally or scale it, make sure, and the idea was to ensure it was linearly scalable, right? Mm-hmm. Well, you can still do that with Kubernetes or any other, you know, containerization that's out there. It's just a matter of still, it's the same concept of doing what we call, or what I call, one vertical slice mm-hmm. first, and that's running, being able to test at just one instance of the web piece and the application and the back end, one slice of that, and determining what the performance characteristics are of that, and then adding one. You know, this the same. It's the same stuff.
Right.
Nothing's really changed.
Right.
I would say the one thing that has changed is ensuring that it's because of auto scaling. There's some additional, but you know, knobs you can turn mm-hmm. to make it scale at a certain speed, and just as importantly, to descale mm-hmm. at a certain rate. You still got to, the business has to pay for all of this stuff. Mm-hmm. The idea is being able to reduce that,
right?
And it all comes back down to dollars and cents. Let's face it, right?
But the more efficient you can make this, the better impact you have on that bill.
On that bill,
bringing it down, so you definitely can see the value immediately when you make those positive changes.
And that's the beautiful thing about performance engineering, and even in the modern cloud, there is a direct correlation with dollars and cents. So that's the second thing you need to do. Besides doing all the technical work, make sure that you determine what that bill is and exactly how much you're shaving off with the different efficiencies that you add to the system.
Thank you so much for being on the show today.
Glad to be here. Thank you for having me.
It's always great to have a conversation with friends like that, like Mike Hawkins, that I've known for so long. You learn so much. I hope you learned as much as I did. And so that concludes another episode of our show. I'm Scott Moore. Thank you for joining me. I'm going to go suffer a little bit more. See you on the road. Everybody, Scott Moore for the Performance Tour, suffering here in a tropical climate in the wintertime. Hey, I want to give a shout out to all the people who showed up at our Nashville. Let's do take two.